today. I'm trying to just keep my composure. Take this message that God has given it to me and say it in that way. But 134 years is something special. Your church still be in existence. That is something that is, as we will see in our word today, it is something to celebrate. First, give an honor to God, to Jesus the Christ, who is our Lord and our Savior, to the Holy Spirit, who is our seal and guarantee of the redemption of our mortal bodies. I'll just, I'm looking at all y'all cool. I'm about to just say right now, go on and shut the air off.
For them. They had seven special feasts.
4 of them in the spring, 3 of them in the fall. At the spring feast, those days were a dress rehearsal for the very coming of Jesus the Christ. And the fall feast days were a dress rehearsal for Jesus' second coming. Now, in our day and age, most churches recognize the church anniversary date as a special feast day, which we will have a little feast after we finish the word today. It's a day set aside where the church is. This day is a reminder. It is an affirmation to its members and the community of that church's commitment to prayer, to teaching and preaching the word, to ministry, to evangelism, to fellowship, to worship, and to discipleship. And then today at 3 p.m., Pastor Chris Restus and the Antioch Christian Fellowship Church from Corinth, Texas, they, among other visiting friends, will come and help us celebrate 134 years of God calling the McKinney First Baptist Church into existence. Now, there are a lot of churches out there, but not all are called by God. So I emphasize the fact we are a church called into existence by God. 134 years is a long time to be in continuous working condition. And today is the day all of us need to have a backward view, but with a forward glance. I want all of us right now to give God a hand clap of praise for 134 years. Now that hand clap is for about 45 years. I broke my clap for giving God a praise for 134 years. Amen. It's been 134 years through the rain, through some storms, through some thistles, through some all kinds of everything. But as the song said, we're still here. Now, so often when you hear the phrase, the best is yet to come, as a theme message, whether it be in the church or in the secular workplace, most envision the best as material or financial rewards. And that may occur in part. But the church should know we will not receive our best in this lifetime. And contrary to what the senior pastor of the largest church in America says, you cannot live your best life now. Not on this side of heaven. Church, our best comes when we come into the presence of Jesus the Christ in heaven, and we get to be reunited with all of our loved ones, past, who of course knew Jesus. Now, although we will not receive our best on this side of heaven, the Bible assures us we can receive all that we need to accomplish kingdom advancement, for Philippians 4:19 affirms, and my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. The Bible affirms that we can receive things that are exceedingly and abundantly above what we could ask or think, as is stated in Ephesians 3:20. And then the Bible says we can expect to receive good things, for Psalm 84:11 affirms, God will not withhold no good thing from those who walk righteously. And conversely, there's another promise the church will receive that it does not like to inform its members of, and that promise is, all who choose to live godly shall suffer persecution. And since we are a church that vehemently proclaims the unadulterated truth, we understand that we are a prime target for Satan. But as our text and our sermon subject will Look again at our text. Verses 3 through 5 again read, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine making requests for you, all the joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. Now, first of all, by way of background and setting, Philippians is the book of joy. It was written under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit by the Apostle Paul. Philippians, along with Colossians, Ephesians, and Philemon, formed what theologians term the prison epistles. These are four books of the Bible where the Apostle Paul wrote under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit while he was in prison. Acts chapter 16, the first Paul and his companions, they actually founded the church at Philippi on his second missionary journey. And the Philippian church was the very first church that was founded on the European continent. And then in verses 3 through 5, Paul clearly reveals his great love for the Philippian people as he demonstrates what a called by God pastor should spend much of his time doing, and that is sharing the word and praying for the people whom God has given him to pastor. And verse 5, it highlights one of the things that brought great joy to Paul, and that was the fellowship of the believers. One of the most beautiful portraits of Christianity is when the saints of God are working together in unity and in love for kingdom advancement. Matter of fact, John chapter 13, verse 35, Jesus said it like this. He said, the world will know that you are my disciples by how you love one another. So conversely, nothing is more spiritually ugly than when so-called Christians are out of fellowship with one another because of envy, because of jealousy, or they're seeking vain glory. Please pay close attention in verse 5 to the fact Paul highlights. He says, from day one, from the moment the church was founded, from the moment the people confessed with their mouth the Lord Jesus and believed in their heart God raised him from the dead, that's the moment that they were saved. From that very day, Paul says, they were a church active and on fire for the Lord. You see, they were active in serving the Lord. The concept of being a member of the first century church and you just attended church service once a week, once a month. Well, I know that ain't amen territory, but it's preaching territory. This concept in first century of coming to church once a week or once a month would have been absolutely foreign to the members of the church at Philippi. And rightly so, it should be foreign to us in our day and age. Jesus never saves anyone so that they can add church attendance to their list of weekly things to do. Nor does Jesus save anyone so that they can live a happy life that is just as self-centered and self-focused as those who are unsaved. Every believer is saved to worship God, to share their faith with the unsaved, and to use their spiritual gift to serve the Lord. And on our 134th year church anniversary, there is no subject we need to reflect upon more so than the essence of verse 6. So let me read it again, since this is where we're going to spend the rest of our time. It says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. The church house located at 401 West Urban Avenue, that's this building. This is not the church. This is the church house. This is the place where we come to meet corporately, to pray, to worship, to conduct ministry, and fellowship and to be taught and trained in the Word of God. But the church is you and I. And there should be nothing more important to the church than the eternal destiny of everyone whom we come in contact with. Paul was most concerned about the church at Philippi being a soul-winning church, more so than he was concerned if they were a mega church. He wanted the church to be most concerned about sharing the authentic gospel. And when you share the authentic gospel, the gospel will also, it is not good news to those who want to live according to their own way. The gospel will offend. If the gospel has to be preached, when you preach the gospel, we've got to preach with equal fervency, love and blessing, as we do preach repentance, and there is a place called hell. The gospel is good news, but the good news is that Jesus has already completed the work on the cross called Calvary, and everybody who desires to be saved can be saved. Paul is saying, that's why Paul starts off in verse 6, he says, being confident. The Greek word translated for confident carries the idea of we are persuaded, we are certain, we are sure of something based on the Word of God. Church, the days we live in can be dark and evil. And based on the Word of God, even darker days are on the horizon. But we are not to be afraid. God has set before faithful churches a door of opportunity to proclaim the gospel of Jesus the Christ like never before. And that which we can have confidence in is the Word of God. We can have confidence that if you exercise Romans 10 and 9 that says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you can have confidence that you will be saved. And then once you are saved, you can have the confidence that once you are saved, you are eternally secure, because John in his gospel said in John 10:12, worst. Look at the B clause of verse 6. Not only can we be confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you, he will complete it. Let me make sure that you understand that the he, who the he is talking to. I don't like a lot of pronouns. That's why when I listen to gospel songs and I hear he and they and all of that, I want to hear Jesus. Because that's power in the name of Jesus. I don't know who he's talking about. First, in this text, Paul, when he says he who has begun a good work, he's talking about God the Father. He's begun a good work. And contextually, the work that God has begun is called salvation. Once God opens up our spiritual eyes to who Jesus is, and we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, you are saved. We are justified by Jesus' atoning and sacrificial blood that was shed on Calvary's cross. And we begin the second phase of the salvation experience called sanctification, which means being saved from the power of sin. Justification meant saved from the penalty of sin. Now, justification occurs in an instant. It happens right when you accept Christ at the point of Romans 10 and 9, when you confess it with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believing in your heart, God raised him from the dead. Listen, my rebellious child, yet right now we may not have no clue how things are going to work out. But based on the word of God, we need to know God does not allow anything to come into our life that he's not going to see us through. Matter of fact, I love the way Romans 8:28 says it.
Projects that will be started, but not all of them. when trouble show up. Too often they quit. They don't complete God's assignment. But if you are not an assignment finisher, you cannot be used mightily for keeping the days. But praise the Lord, God is not like us. God is not like me. Since he has begun a good work, it's guaranteed he's going to finish. So if you are in the crucibles of trials, but you are saved, you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, don't worry. God will finish what he started in you. And you'll be able to say like Job did in Job chapter 23 and verse 10, when he said, when he has tested me, I shall come forth as gold. You got to get tested before you be gold. See, there's a lot of fools going around here. It ain't been tested. It look like gold, but it ain't gold. When you check the properties out, when you put it under the test, it is going to show you that it's not the real thing. How we are tested is through this word. We are tested when we stand on the word, even though we can't see where we're going. We just know God said go that direction. And when you start going, he'll start showing. So put away your doubts. Put away your fears. Those things are not of God. Stand on the truth. Live by faith. Believe and be excited about what God is doing. And we will continue and what he will continue to do in our life and in the life of the church. The good work that God has begun at TMFBC, the good work God has begun in you as an individual is absolutely guaranteed to turn out to be successful. No. Y'all know I love my New Orleans Saints. Y'all know me. I remember the last game of the season last year. Of course, this is applicable to the Texans. I remember the last game played in Atlanta. Because we weren't going to the playoffs, at first I didn't even want to watch the game, so I just taped it. As I was going home, because we had some other things we had to do, I just so happened to, my wife has the Sirius in the car, so I put it on the NFL Network channel, and I heard that the Saints beat Atlanta. It was a close game, but the Saints won. So when I got home, I went on and turned on the TV. You know what?
more serious in our walk with you. That we get more serious in going out and preaching the unsaved for you. We love you, Lord. We thank you and we praise you. In the majesty and in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, and I pray in your name.